Let me introduce our speaker today, which is Dr. Christian Smorra, who is a group leader at the University of Mainz, currently setting up the base step experiment, which is a transportable antiproton trap. So Christian received his PhD in 2012 under the supervision of Klaus Blaum, dealing with ultra precise mass measurements on radioactive isotopes using panning traps. So afterwards, he joined the base collaboration as a postdoc at RIKEN Fundamental Symmetries Laboratory, where he made substantial contributions to the setup and development of the base experiment at CERN. Then from 2014, he continued working at base, but based on one of the very competitive CERN fellowship contracts. And moved later back to RIKEN. And within this time frame, Christian performed the most precise measurement of the antiproton magnetic moment with a fractional precision of 1.5 parts in a billion, which improved previous best measurements by more than a factor of 3,000. He also contributed to the most precise measurement of the proton to antiproton charge to mass ratio with a fractional precision of 69 parts in a trillion. And very recently, Christian proposed the development of a transportable trap for antiprotons based step, which will allow future measurements of antimatter based fundamental constants at considerably improved precision. So the proposal is supported by an ERC starting grant, and the development of the device is currently ongoing in his laboratory at the University of Mainz. So Christian is also the local team leader of the Base Mainz experiment, where the collaboration implements new measurement technologies and focuses on important improved measurements of the proton magnetic moment. And very recently, the team at Mainz achieved an important technological milestone and managed to demonstrate for the first time the sympathetic cooling of protons by coupling the particles to laser-cooled beryllium ions. And in his talk today, Christian will report about these very recent developments. And well, Christian, we are very much looking forward to your talk. And with this, I leave the floor to you.
Okay, thank you very much, Stefan, for this introduction. I think I don't need to tell a lot then anymore on the first slide here. So today I will focus on the sympathetic cooling of protons that we recently demonstrated here in our laboratory in Mainz. And we are of course interested in doing this in perspective on the precision measurements on protons and antiprotons, and to improve the precision in the future. So we have here a couple of topics that I want to cover today. So starting with the motivation, looking at the relevance of these measurements. Then we have one new type of search that we can do with trapped ions or antiprotons. It's a search of millicharged particles. Then we have the sympathetic cooling of the protons. And at the end of the talk, we'll also talk about the transportable trap for antiprotons as part of improving the experimental precision. So why are we interested in doing these measurements? So we have today still a struggle in particle physics. So we have the standard model that describes the fundamental particles and their interactions. And it holds very well in laboratory tests. So we have, for example, the discovery of the Higgs boson, which completed the particle content of the standard model. But we have also very accurate precision tests of the standard model, for example, looking at the QED corrections to the electron G factor and the measurement of the fine structure constant. These are measurements that test the standard model with a relative precision of a few parts in 10 to the minus 11. Okay. On the contrary, we have observations in cosmology and in astronomy that don't match at all with the standard model. So we know that there's about 5 times more dark matter than baryonic matter in the universe, and that is not contained in the standard model. We also know that the universe, the expansion of the universe is accelerating, whereas we expect it actually to slow down due to gravitation. And we don't know what the reason for this acceleration is. So that's something which we've called dark energy, where we also don't know what that is. And the last point here is that we don't observe any primordial antimatter in the universe. So if we look at this energy content chart, there's 0.0% due to antimatter. And we don't know why we have this matter excess in the universe. So if we look at our theory, then we have antiparticles very naturally contained in the standard model. They arise if we develop a relativistic quantum theory. So they were first predicted from Dirac's equation, and now in they are also, of course, contained in quantum field theory and part of the standard model. Quantum field theory has Lorentz invariance as fundamental symmetry because we want it to be a relativistic theory. And one can show, that's called the CPT theorem, that a local Lorentz invariant quantum field theory is also invariant under the CPT transformation. So, and that's the combination of the three discrete symmetries, parity, charge, and time reversal, that's illustrated here. Okay, and so CPT invariance has various consequences. So the first of them is that we need to make identical observations in one system and in its CPT transformed state. And that's only possible if we have identical fundamental properties for conjugate particle and antiparticles, like masses, lifetime, charges, and magnetic moments, here with a reversed sign. Another consequence is that we have when we convert energy into matter, so that means a boson is going into a fermion antifermion pair, as here shown here in this vacuum polarization loop. So these kind of reactions have always to be a pair creation or a pair annihilation process in our theory. So, and that's a bit in contrast to the astronomical observations that we make. So if we think that the universe was created in a symmetric Big Bang, for example, we expect that we have actually equal amounts of matter and antimatter in the universe. But if we look at this baryon asymmetry parameter, which is called little eta here, that's basically the baryon density minus the antibaryon density, which we assume to be zero, divided by the number of photons in the universe. So then, we clearly see that there is no antimatter left. Okay, and somehow this matter excess needs to be generated. And there are the so-called Sakharov conditions that define a scenario that is needed to make this matter excess, the so-called baryogenesis. So we need a baryon number violating process and C and CP violation. and the thermal non-equilibrium. And all of this is plausible to happen within the standard model. However, if we look at the numeric result, it's several orders of magnitude less than what we actually observe. Okay, we could also another way to think where the antimatter is hiding would be that we have kind of a patchwork universe with matter and antimatter bubbles. Okay, and one can also look for these looking at higher energy cosmic radiation or X-ray and gamma radiation that would come from annihilation radiation. And we find that these so we can also basically exclude this based on the observations that we have. Kind of related to this problem of this matter antimatter asymmetry, we want to compare the fundamental properties of protons and antiprotons as one way in searching for the unknown. So I mean, we don't know where the what the new physics is that is hiding from us. And there are various ways to look for this. I mean, we have, for example, direct production methods for new particles at the LHC. We can search for very rare events using, for example, these kind of low counting experiments. Like here, for example, the xenon one-ton experiment, where you basically try to detect dark matter particles scattering in a large volume detector. Or we have the precision measurements, like, for example, the proton trap system that we have here in Mainz, where we want to search for tiny deviations from the predictions of the standard model. For example, the G factor of the particles, or another example would be EDM experiments. So the tool that we want to look at today, kind of to test the standard model and to search for the new physics, is such a Penning trap system that is used for these precision measurements. But we'll also look at that we can use this Penning trap actually as a kind of particle detector. Okay, so first we start with the basics. We want to understand here how our measurement system is composed. So we basically use a single particle that's confined in a Penning trap that consists out of a homogeneous magnetic field and out of a stack of electrodes that we use to apply an electric field. So that's our typical configuration. We apply a voltage to the ring electrode, and that confines then the particle in the axial direction along the magnetic field lines. So this wound state here of the particle in the trap can be viewed somehow in a similar way as an atom. However, our magnetic field and electric field is not created by another fundamental particle. So we need to construct magnetic fields that are very stable. And also we need very stable voltage sources if we want to make here very precise measurements. Okay. How can we detect the particle in the trap? So all the motional frequencies that the particle has, they are in the radio frequency range and below. So our favorite detection technique for this is that we make a non-destructive detection using a superconducting LC circuit to convert the image currents that the particle makes when it moves in the trap into a voltage signal that we can then pick up here and amplify and read out in a, with an FFT analyzer. Okay. And what is very important here, also looking at the cooling methods that we want to make, is that we have here a system that consists out of two oscillators. So we have the particle in the trap. So we construct our trap essentially in a way that we have a harmonic axial motion along the magnetic field lines. And the second part, the resonator here, is basically an electrical oscillator with a resonance frequency defined by the inductance and the capacitance of the circuit. So these two systems are coupled for the detection. Okay. And this here is a typical spectrum that we observe. So the series LC circuit that represents the particle is short at the resonance frequency, which we see here. And the other part of the spectrum is basically created by the Johnson noise of the effective parallel resistance of the circuit. So that gives you this part here of the curve. Okay. So and when the particle is interacting with the circuit, it's also cooled. So it dissipates energy until it reaches the thermal equilibrium. And so this here is an FFT spectrum that's taken in thermal equilibrium. And we have a damping rate for here in this case of about 100 beryllium ions that is defined by this equation. And you can also see the basically the damping parameter in the spectrum here. It appears here in the width of this short. Yeah. Okay, and the width of the LC circuit is essentially defined by the Q factor of the system. So and that's typically 10,000 or higher, because we build it as a superconducting LC circuit with very low losses. The temperature of the system depends a little bit on your surroundings. So ideally, you would want to have the system at liquid helium temperature. However, we read out the FFT spectrum with an amplifier, and there's some noise feedback, and therefore the temperature of the system can vary a bit. Okay. So, and here on the right side is another plot that kind of shows that we are dealing here with a coupled oscillator system. So what we are doing here is that we have basically the resonator at a constant frequency, and then we change the ring voltage of the beryllium ions. So, and their frequency is basically here in this minimum that moves linearly across our plot here. And we see that this, if we not look at the minima, but at the maxima, we see here that there is a separation. And that's kind of similar to an avoided crossing that we would have in a coupled oscillator system. Okay, you can, so one can do the math, and one can actually see that this is the response that you expect if you couple an undamped and a damped oscillator. Okay, so now coming back to the aspect of what kind of things we can detect with our particle in the Penning trap. So we have three eigenmotions in the trap. One of them is the axial motion that I already mentioned, that is basically defined by the electric field that we apply. And in the radial plane, we have two circular motions, the magnetron motion, and the reduced cyclotron motion. And we can measure all of these three frequencies with the image current detection. And then we can also use the so-called invariance theorem, where we combine all the three frequency and end up with a quantity that doesn't depend on the trap voltage. And that allows us essentially to extract the charge to mass ratio. So that's the free cyclotron frequency of the particle. Okay, you can also look at internal states of your trap particle. So one example would be for the proton and the antiproton. I think there's only one possibility. So it's the spin state of the particle. And we could look here at the spin precession frequency. But of course, if you trap something else, like for example, helium-3 ion, you could also look at the transitions in this atomic ion. Okay. And in general, if we measure these frequencies, we measure a frequency here, this transition frequency, and we have some expectation for that from the standard model. So for example, we expect the proton and antiproton spin precession frequencies to be identical in the same magnetic field. And that's something which we can test experimentally. So if there's some offset between these two frequencies, or we can also use look for time variations of this level spacing that could arise, for example, within the standard model extension, or when we are searching for axions, for example, that's things we have already looked at. Okay. So another way of using the Penning trap would be to use it as a kind of particle detector with some very special properties. And there have been recently two papers about this. So one is from the Hefner group that was published in PRL. And the second one is now on archive. It's from Peter Graham and Hari Ramani at Stanford. So, and yeah, we have basically some possibilities to look for very small energy changes in these traps. So first of all, when we are non-destructively detecting these the trap particles, we have the possibility to count the number of particles as a function of time. So since the width of our short here is proportional to the number of trapped particles. Okay, and this is something which we did in our reservoir trap. So you see here basically, so that was done in the base trap at CERN. So you see here, yeah, the number of antiprotons as function of time. We start with 18, we end with one at the end, so we can count them with a single particle sensitivity. And the number decreased here because we took antiprotons away for our precision measurements. But in principle, you are also able to look here at loss rates due to scattering with some, let's say, some dark matter particle for recombination rates, if you have, for example, highly charged ions, or of course also annihilation with background gas. So you could use it also as a let's say as a pressure gauge. Yeah. Okay, but in principle, yeah, or you can of course also look at the decay of the antiproton and set some limits on that. The other possibility is that we detect the energy deposition in the trap of the trap particles when it, for example, scatters with another charged particle. And there are various ways to do this. And what we need to do here is basically we need to make a non-ideal Penning trap. So we have to introduce a magnetic field gradient here. This is the quadratic term, which we call the magnetic bottle, or we have to make the axial potential anharmonic, and then we can observe frequency shifts that depend on the energy of the stored particle. Okay, and we have here, if we use this magnetic bottle trap, we have a frequency shift of about 0.8 hertz per microelectron volt, and that allows us roughly to determine the energy with 60 nanoelectron volts resolution. Okay, and if we look at the level spacings of our artificial Penning trap atom, these are kind of the numbers we end up with, and the lowest energy transfer that you could think of detecting would be about 40 picoelectron volts. So that would be a single magnetron quantum, but we are not quite there yet. Okay. So good. And now I want to talk a little bit about these kind of measurements. So if we want to look at this energy transfer, the best thing we can do is that we use our so-called analysis trap, which we've built to detect the spin state of the proton and antiproton. So this uses a magnetic potential to modify the axial frequency depending on the spin state of the particle. Okay, that's here in the magnetic moment of the magnetic potential. Okay, and so we couple basically the spin magnetic moment to the axial motion. That's this term here, but we also couple the magnetic the angular momentum from the radial motion to the axial mode. So we end up with this dependence on the cyclotron and the magnetron energy. Okay, and this here is our demonstration of detecting the spin state of the particle, but you can also look at it now as that we are able to detect basically an energy change in the of about 200 nanoelectron volts in the energy of the trapped particle. Okay. if we apply no drive to make spin flips, so that's what we've done here, then we can look at how stable the axial frequency is without any interaction. And then we assume that basically that we have a residual electric field noise in the trap, and that drives the radial modes of the trap particle. Okay, and the transition rate depends on the energy in the mode, and usually we do these kind of measurements with a very cold particles, so typically about 100 millikelvin in the cyclotron mode. That's about quantum number 100. Okay, to make it small, and it also depends, of course, on the electric field noise density in the trap, and as a consequence, you end up basically with a random walk in the radial energy or radial quantum number, and that gives rise to a certain frequency fluctuation after a certain averaging time. Okay, and so and then to kind of determine the magnitude of this transition rate, we do this kind of Allen deviation analysis, So we look at basically how large the axial frequency fluctuation is as function of averaging time. And there we have then the random walk contribution from these cyclotron transition rates that we can basically determine if we look at the frequency fluctuation at long averaging times. Okay, and if we do that, we find out that our transition rates are really very low, something like below 10 transitions per hour. And if we put this into this graph where one compares basically the heating rates of different trap systems, we end up here in the bottom, and that corresponds to a voltage noise density of about 200 picovolt per square root hertz. Okay, so it's for sure one of the systems with the lowest heating rates that we can have. And that's then interesting to put some limits on the scattering with milli-charged particles. So this is a type of extension to the standard model that you can assume that there are particles with which carry a small fractional charge that's smaller than the elementary charge. And that would, of course, if we would find that, that would violate the charge quantization. That's one possibility. The second possibility would be actually that there's some kinematic mixing of a dark photon with a standard model photon, and that could produce particles with an effectively smaller charge. Okay, there are various kinds to search for these particles. That's of course possible to look for these in collider and beam dump experiments, like in a way of directly producing and detecting the particles. Or there are of course also Millikan-like experiments. So you can think of, for example, that millicharges, if that charge is large enough that they get stuck on a heavy nucleus, yeah, and that this would then lead to to objects which with a an offset fractional charge that you could detect somehow. Okay, you could also think of and if there are positive milli charges, they also found form bound states with electrons, but they usually ionize because they are not very strongly bound. And so the one can assume that these positive milli charges build up kind of on Earth and in our laboratory, and one can assume that the transition rate that we observe in our analysis trap, that this arises basically from scattering with these milli-charged particles. Okay, and if we and then there, Peter and Harry, they have worked out the limits that we can place based on these heating rates that we measured, and you see here that the antiproton heating rate can actually exclude here a large parameter space on this plot. And there are also limits from other groups. I think this here is, I think it's the Bollinger group, and this here is from the Thomson group. So depending on your trap frequencies and the mass of the ion you use, your exclusion region moves around, and you can set here some some limits on these milli-charged particles. Okay, one thing to mention if we go back is of course that these heating rates would be much lower if our particle temperature would be lower. So we are here at about 100 millikelvin. So if we would want to do this better, we could cool our antiproton more and end up with a more sensitive measurement. Okay, but first, how do we actually get 100 millikelvin antiproton? So if we go back a few minutes, so we have seen that we use resistive cooling as a method to cool down our particles, and there we are limited at a temperature around the liquid helium temperature, so 4.2 Kelvin. And to work around this, we have applied the so-called selective resistive cooling, and that works in the following way. So you have a single particle in your trap, and here in this trap you have that's the trap where you can measure the cyclotron energy, and up here you have a trap with a cyclotron detector that thermalizes basically the cyclotron mode with the temperature of the detection system. Okay, and so if you want to cool the particle, you move the particle here, wait until it's thermalized, and then you move it back, and then you measure basically the frequency shift from the zero line that gives you the then the energy of the particle. And if it's too high, you have to repeat the entire thing until you get a particle that is cold enough. Okay. And so depending on the temperature of your resistor, this can take a very long time. So for example, for the antiproton, we needed about 12 hours to cool below 100 millikelvin. With the proton, it was a little bit better. We were able to reach a lower cyclotron detector temperature here in our lab in Mainz, and that worked within, let's say, about 2 hours on average. Okay, but one could still think of having something better. So just as an example, if we had a method with a temperature of 100 millikelvin and 1 minute cooling time, we would already reach we would reach a higher frequency stability in the magnetic bottle. We would have close to 100% spin flip fidelity in our magnetic moment measurements. And yeah, we would have the lower cyclotron transition rates. We would be able to measure much faster. So typically, due to these long cooling times, our magnetic moment measurements take something like 4 months or so with 100 data points. So if we are able to cool faster, we would have higher statistics. And we would also be able to lower systematic shifts in our measurements. So if you have nothing else that shifts your frequencies, you will still have the relativistic shift when you excite the particles, and that's for protons about 10 to the minus 9 per electron volt kinetic energy. So if you want to make a 10 to the minus 12 measurement, let's say, then you need to control and measure your particle energy already with a milli electron volt precision. So at some point, we will be happy if our systematic shifts will be much lower. So then what kind of cooling methods are available? So we have the resistive cooling method that basically brings us to the cryogenic environment temperature. The nice thing is that it can be applied to all trapped charged particles, and it's non-destructive, yeah, for single ions. It gets a little bit less powerful if you want to cool heavy singly charged ions, because it's getting very slow. So this for the axial mode, for example, you have a Hertz cooling rate for the proton, but that would be a couple of minutes if you go to a mass 200 ion or something like this. Okay. If you want to have lower temperatures, there's of course direct laser cooling, and that has been shown that you can essentially cool to the motional ground state of the trap. This requires, however, a closed laser cooling cycle on your trap particle with suitable transition frequencies. And there are just really a couple of ions that are frequently used. And so it can be applied only to a very few species. Okay. And in the middle, we have here the sympathetic laser cooling. So here we would co-trap one of these ions with our particle of interest. And cool them together in the same potential well. It's a method that you can use with when you have particles with the same charge of sign. So if you want to apply this to the antiproton, it would be difficult because cooling negative ions is a challenge by itself. So the question is, can we not just have the best of everything? So we want a cooling method that's applicable to all charged particles. We want laser cooling temperatures down to the ground state and no co-trapping required. So that will allow us to apply this then also to the antiproton. And even if it would be for a proton, at the end, the Coulomb interaction with the other particle would disturb our measurement. So we really want a solution that requires no co-trapping. And the method here has been proposed by Heinzen and Wineland already a long time ago. And that is basically to form a system of coupled harmonic oscillators, where you have one particle that can be laser cooled and your particle of interest. And you have somehow a coupling force between these two particles. Okay. So, and then if you can do that, you see here a little simulation where the proton and the beryllium ion are coupled, and you see that they periodically exchange energy. And then if you can apply laser cooling to one of the particles, you see that you can take out a large fraction of the energy in the system by applying the laser cooling as close to the maximum energy. Okay. So how can you realize this coupling? There has been some pioneering work in radio frequency traps that has been done by the Wineland group and also by the Blood group around 10 years ago. So you can make the energy exchange via Coulomb interactions. So you bring the particles in such a microstructure trap very close to each other so that they can Coulomb interact, and then you have the energy exchange between the two ions, and that goes quite fast. So you have here rates that are in the kilohertz range. Okay. This is, however, very difficult to be used in a panning trap because we have typically structures that are already millimeters large to make our traps. So it's not possible to bring the particles such close to each other using the traps we typically construct. Okay, but there's a second way, and that is that you make the interaction via the image currents. So you have a common end-cap electrode, where both particles induce image currents, and then these two particles can interact via the voltage that is induced by the image currents on this shared electrode, okay? And that can be also shown converted into a circuit diagram. So you would have here two series LC circuits that charge up a common capacitor that is this common end cap electrode, okay? You can calculate the energy exchange rate of this process depends on the effective electrode distance of the particles to this common end cap electrode. And it also depends on the impedance of the electrode to ground. So, okay. And if you want to make this fast enough, you need to make a small trap. You need a low capacitance so that you induce a large voltage by the image current. And you need to be sufficiently fast because if you want to form this coupled oscillator system, you have to get the axial oscillation frequencies of the two particles to the same value. And then you have to make the energy exchange before the particle frequencies drift off. So that's also something that you need to consider when you build a system. Okay, and this here is this was our first approach. So, and these are the people that have been working on this. So Andy Moser and Georg Schneider started to design this coupling trap experiment. And then Matt joined at the beginning, followed by Markus, and Christian Will joined us when we were almost at starting the second approach. So, but I'll come to that later. So, yes, so our first approach was to design this two-trap system that has here in the middle this common end cap electrode. It's actually formed by the four electrodes that sit between the two ring electrodes. They are all RF-wise connected to each other and function as the common end cap. Okay. The reason for this is that we want to minimize this effective electrode distance, and there we just need every surface that we have to contribute. Okay. then the next thing that you need to do is that you need to minimize the capacitance of this electrode, and in particular that concerns the transition between the correction electrodes and the ring electrodes here. So you have to maximize these gaps and get these this trap capacitance as much down as possible. Okay. And that's what we did. And if we run the numbers, we end up with a cooling time that is about 110 seconds divided by the square root of the number of beryllium ions that we have in the trap. Okay. So, and then to kind of get this rate above these, the stability limit that we need to do the coupling, we decided then to build a trap system that couples about 100 beryllium ions to a single proton so that we can do this energy exchange. Okay, and this here is the trap system that we have, that we have built, features the coupling trap here. On the left side, here is an ionization region that we use to make beryllium ions with an ablation laser. And here are some windows for the cooling laser for the beryllium ions. On the other side, we had an electron gun to make protons. Okay, and then we have essentially here a trap system that is meant to do the proton G factor measurement. Okay, and in particular, we wanted to use the analysis trap with a magnetic bottle to measure the temperature of the cooled protons in this trap. Okay, so we've spent quite a lot of time with the system, but I'm not going to show you any results because we had a lot of technical problems with the system. And in particular, these traps are very small and you are very sensitive to any voltage offsets on the surfaces. And so if you have, and it was a challenge to, let's say, operate these traps in a reproducible way after shooting the electron gun or after loading the laser. You had basically to start over again, optimizing your traps, and that was, very challenging. So, and then that's why we decided to go for the second approach, where we used two other traps in our system, the proton trap here and the storage trap, which was at the time of the experiment, of this experiment, moved actually in this spot between the beryllium trap and the ablation target. Okay. And we realized that these two traps are also coupled because they are connected to the same cryogenic LC circuit. So each trap has an electrode here that we use kind of to pick up the image current. And then the particles are, and then actually this LC circuit, it amplifies the image current signal by the Q factor. So you boost basically this coupling process by having this cryogenic LC circuit here. Okay, this here is a typical signal that you see. So this is the resonance of the LC circuit. Then we have here the proton, and here I think this is even a single beryllium ion. Okay, and if you match then the frequency of the proton and the beryllium ion, you can have actually some energy exchange. Okay, if you calculate the rates for that, it's quite fast. Yeah, it's essentially the damping constant of the detection system, what you end up with. Okay, so we were thinking that we can couple the two ions in this way. And so we tried to essentially the same thing that I've shown in the beginning, where we just had the resonator and the beryllium ions in the trap. We've done the same thing here with a proton at a fixed frequency in one trap and the beryllium in the other trap. We applied the voltage ramp here to move the axial frequency of the beryllium across the one of the proton. And that's what we ended up with in our heat map plot. It's not quite an avoided crossing because it's a coupling of three harmonic oscillators. So it looks a little bit different. It has a degeneration here in actually when you match the two ion frequencies. Yeah, but this is essentially what we expect when we calculate the impedance of this circuit, which is a coupling of three LC oscillators. Okay. In this measurement, there was no laser on or anything like this. So all the components here were thermalized to the effective noise temperature of the LC circuit. Okay, and then we were thinking if we can actually show that we can exchange energy between the particles. So the first thing we did is that we wanted to excite the beryllium ions, because that's kind of the easier measurement. You can see a large frequency shift if you do that. Okay, and that worked in the following way. So this is kind of our starting configuration. We have the proton on the top of the LC circuit, and here a cloud of beryllium ions. And then we have a parametric drive that excites the beryllium ions, and that is applied only in the beryllium trap. So if we switch the drive on and the beryllium ions are off resonant, not much happens to the proton, yeah. But if we put the beryllium on resonance and the proton off resonance, we see that the beryllium ions are heated, and we chose the excitation amplitude in a way that we don't see a peak yet for the beryllium ion, that we just end up with a smaller dip. Okay, and then if you place the proton on top of this heated beryllium ion dip, you see that the proton gives you a peak signal, because its damping rate is smaller. Yeah. Okay. And if you are in this configuration, you can actually then apply a sideband pulse to put the energy of the axial energy of the proton into its cyclotron mode. And then you can measure the radial energy afterwards as a frequency shift. And that's what's shown here. So, and that's, you see that there's a clear difference between having the beryllium on resonance and having it off resonance, and also a control measurement when there's no drive applied. Okay, that's actually still a little bit lower, but the difference between the off and on resonant is very significant here. Okay, the next step is that we wanted to cool the particles, and I actually let we cannot see the the plot, sorry. So like this. Okay, so can we cool the particles was our next question. So we started to use the laser, and if we look in our circuit model, the laser acts like a resistor. it changes the temperature of all the components of our LC circuit. Okay. And what we kind of expect when we add this resistance here is shown in this plot over here. So depending on how strong we do the laser cooling, we see a different signature. So first of all, if we apply no laser cooling, we end up with this gray dashed curve. So that would be like our usual dip signal. Okay, and then as we start to increase the resistance, we see that the dip of the beryllium ions get shallower, and that we just have the proton signal left in the middle here. Okay, and as the resistance goes up, we actually start to decouple the beryllium ions from the proton and the LC circuit, because let's say if the resistance here is infinite, there's no current that can flow through this part of the circuit, so it would be then completely decoupled. Okay, and we see this also here. If the damping laser damping goes up at some point, the signal looks very much like basically a proton dip without beryllium ions in the beryllium trap. Okay, we can also see this effect when we look at the let's say, at the temperature of the LC circuit. So this here, this change in the impedance model tells us basically just how the shape of the resonance changes. It does not include the temperature change itself yet. But what happens if you change the temperature is that the signal to noise of the resonator of the LC circuit will also get lower. And that's what we see here. Yeah, and these measurements are for different laser intensities. This is like zero laser intensity. And then you increase the laser intensity, and then here it is too high. And then you see basically that you have just the uncooled resonator left. Okay, so we observe here kind of that we can cool the LC circuit. The question is, can we also cool the proton? Yes, we can, and we can observe the the temperature change of the proton by applying a laser intensity where we can still clearly identify the proton signal here. And then if we then use an anharmonic trap potential, we can see a frequency shift if we measure the proton frequency once before putting the laser cooled beryllium ions on resonance, and once when they are there. Then we can measure these kind of slopes here, and they are calibrated, and they allow us to basically measure the temperature change. Okay, and here you see a measurement where we kind of varied the laser detuning and the number of beryllium ions trying to get the proton temperature down as much as possible. And so we ended up with these parameters here. So basically we reached about cooling of 85% of the environment temperature. So we started here at 70 Kelvin and ended up with about 2.6 Kelvin. Okay, and the cooling is here, of course, limited by the thermal noise on the LC circuit. So if you want to reach a lower temperature, you have to work on removing this thermal noise from the LC circuit. So I'm seeing that we are quite advanced in time. So I think I will speed the rest a little bit up. So one reason why we couldn't do this in this experiment was that our resonator was at a fixed frequency, and presently we are working on an upgraded apparatus where we will have a cryogenic switch that is based on a commercial cryogenic piezo stage that allows us to switch the LC circuits away, so that we can either do the common NCAD coupling, or we can do this LC circuit coupling, but with the proton and the beryllium detuned from the resonator, and that will lower the heating effect. And we have run some simulations. So this was done by Christian Will. That show that if we use a pulsed laser scheme, I'm sorry, this here should be transparent, but it's not. Yeah. So if we use a pulsed laser scheme and either the common NCAP coupling without LC circuit or off resonant coupling, we can see that we reach a temperature at least in the 10 millikelvin range and cooling time constants that are below 12 seconds. And that's kind of our next goal regarding the cooling. Okay, and in the end, of course, we want to apply this technique to improve the CPT invariance tests. In particular, we want to measure here in Mainz the proton G factor with a higher precision. That's currently measured to 0.3 parts per billion. And we expect when we have the laser cooling working that we can decrease this here by another order of magnitude. Okay. At some point, of course, we also want to laser cool the antiprotons and do precision measurements with that. But there we have to work on a second improvement that is related to the magnetic field noise that we are experiencing when we measure in the antiproton decelerator hall. So if you recall that our frequencies depend all on the magnetic field, it is clear that and we kind of rely on them to cancel out when we measure frequency ratios. So any temporal instability here will constitute a limit to the measurement precision. Okay. And the antiproton decelerator, it's a synchrotron, so it ramps its magnetic field up and down during every deceleration cycle. And that's kind of what we measure if we place a magnetic field sensor near the base trap system, and we can figure out when we see these fluctuations roughly where the noise limit is that is imposed by these magnetic field fluctuations. So to work around this at some point, we want to relocate the measurements offline, and we think we can do this because we had already a stationary reservoir trap in the base experiment that was running for a year, and that was enough to do kind of two precision measurements in this time. So we think we can also do it in a transportable trap so that we then do the measurements somewhere else. Okay. And therefore we started this transportable trap project that's called Base Step. And this is a sketch of the setup that we want to place in the former ATRAP 1 area. So this here is our transportable magnet. It's a superconducting magnet that will have a double trap system inside. We need a kind of injection and ejection port to the trap. So we need therefore a differential pumping section to make a good trap vacuum in the middle. And here we need to build a few beamline elements to connect our trap to this vertical extraction port. So we are currently preparing the setup here, and we hope to be there in 2022 for the physics run next year to catch the first antiprotons. We'll skip through this. We use a commercial superconducting magnet for the transportable trap that has a few special features. It's a persistent magnet so that we don't need to a current source during the transport. And it has a hybrid cooling system. So it uses a cryocooler in stationary mode, or when you have a generator during the transport, you can also use the cryocooler to keep your magnet and your trap chamber cold. In addition, it has also a liquid helium tank. So if the cryocooler goes off, either because you want to transport or because you have a power cut or something, you have here a buffer that keeps your trap system cold for something like at least 8 hours. Yeah, so you can even think of doing a short-term transport without powering the cryocooler on the way. Yeah. Another special feature is that it has a special support structure. So it's like a hexapod structure that holds the cryo stage and that's strong enough to withstand acceleration forces that you that can occur during the transport. Okay. Yeah, I'll skip through this and just say that we start to have all the components ready that we need to assemble the trap system. We have already completed the setup of our cryogenic detection segment. We have at the moment 4 detection systems running in our cold head, and that's already ready to plug on to the transportable trap when it's assembled. Okay, the last point, we also started to look at permanent magnet trap systems, because I mean, the commercial magnets, superconducting magnets, are quite expensive, whereas this setup here that consists of about 60 permanent magnet rods and some aluminium holders costs less than €1,000. So if you can use this as a storage or a transport device, this would be, of course, very interesting, because you could have multiple of these transport systems at some point. Okay, so we've built this kind of OBEA configuration of permanent magnets and tested it at 4 Kelvin. And we think it's the field strength is enough to transport for transport purposes. Okay, yeah, maybe as a last slide, when we have the transportable trap ready, we would want to, of course, improve the CPT invariance tests with protons and antiprotons. That means improving the charge to mass ratio and the magnetic moment measurements. And for this, we are planning to have kind of an offline laboratory at CERN outside the AD hall, and where we want to kind of put all the equipment that we have in the collaboration together and build the, let's say, the best penning trap system for making these precision measurements as good as we can. So that means we bring our also our quantum lodging methods, which are developed in Hannover, to CERN, and have here a trap system that is supplied by the transportable trap. Okay. There's, of course, a few more things that we thought about when we started the transportable trap. So a few things that you could do when you have multiple antiproton experiments is that you would kind of do a topological dark matter search. That's something that is done with atomic clocks, yeah, but we could do it also with an antimatter clock at different locations, or of course that we measure the gravitational redshift of the antiprotons in different locations. But I think we have already concluded here that the elliptic orbit of the Earth around the Sun is a better way to change the gravitational potential. But if you would want to do a measurement with an active modification, that's of course that's something you could do with a transportable trap. Okay, yes, so this brings me to my summary. So we've talked about detection and limits on the millicharge density in our lab. We've talked about the sympathetic cooling of the trapped proton, and very briefly about the transportable trap for antiprotons. Okay, so thank you for your attention.